I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high.
Sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my batalha no meu momento, quando eu chego.
It really does amaze me, living off your love for me. Sometimes it really does amaze me, living off your love, do 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 do.
Back from the farm, and I thought it'd be fun to show you all the bridge that we have to cross during rainy season. So,
I never had a mother to hold me in her arms just like the other kids I knew. I am an orphan, alone and wild. You say, come to me just like a child. Yeah, sometimes it really does amaze me.
So here we are on the farm, and you see these vines climbing up. Those are called pinions. And they put out a wheat that we fry with French fries. And then Michael here is working on the wheat.
You felt the pain of cold steel spikes.
Good morning, church family, and those of you watching online, thank you for joining us. I'm excited today because we're doing things a little different, and we're going to have a little children's time here in a minute. But first, I just wanted to let you know, those people that you saw on that video are Guy and Kayla Burkhead and their family, and they minister to the Glaro people in Africa, and we partner with them, or one of our missionaries that we send out and support, and they gave us that video to give you a little taste of life in Africa and some of their ministry opportunities and working with the Glaro people and teaching them written language so they can share the gospel of Christ with them. And so continue to pray with them, and I encourage you, if you see them around, because they're home right now, they're living in our missionary house, if you see them, stop and talk to them, ask them about their ministry. They say if you ever see their van over there parked, come stop in, we'd love to talk. So for those of you that have prayer requests or you have something you need to let us know as a church, you can fill out a Connect card in the pew. For those of you watching online, you can follow the link to the Connect card. And us as the staff, we like to pray over those cards each week. And so if you guys have anything you need prayer for, please let us know, and we'll help you in support by praying over your needs and those issues in your life. I am excited. We're doing kids stuff this morning. And one thing for kids, as we move into December, one thing for you families, I have an activity for 25 days leading up to Christmas. And it starts with creation and goes through Jesus' birth. It's called the Jesse Tree. There are ornaments that you can cut out and put together and then hang on your Christmas tree. And it follows the story, the Bible story, essentially, from creation to Jesus' birth. There's a front side and back side, and then there's a sheet of paper that tells you scripture to read with each ornament that you do each day. If you would like one of those at the end of service, I will be at Center Point with those packets. You guys can see me there and pick those up. All right, so we're going to move into the children's time. So I need children to come join me up here on stage, because Wednesday nights we've been doing children's ministry here in the chapel, and I'm going to give you a little taste of some of the stuff that we do on a Wednesday night. So you guys can come up, and right now you can stand right here in front of me. Just, you can look at me, or you can look at the audience. It's up to you. Wonderful. See, it's so exciting to see all of these kids. All right. So, typically, on a Wednesday night, we always open up with some kind of game or activity. And this month, for Thanksgiving in November, we've been talking about this word called gratitude. And gratitude is letting others know you see how they've helped you. Letting people know that you are... Anybody know another word for gratitude? Thankful. That's right. Giving thanks, showing our way of showing thanks to those that have done things for us, given us stuff, what God has done for us, ways to be thankful. So we're going to do a little fun activity, and it's something similar to rock, paper, scissors. It's called hug, shake, clap, thank you. Hug, shake, clap, thank you. All right, so let me show you. You're going to have to look at me, or you can look up on the sign. All right, so here's the deal. You're going to hug, you're going to shake, or you're going to clap. Okay, yeah, I can't clap with a, you get a clap, right? All right, so hug beats shake, shake beats clap beats hug. All right, and if you really need to know, it's up on the screen, okay? So we're gonna practice that. You ready? I'm going to say 3, 2, 1, thank you, and on thank you, you're going to do your action. Make sense? It's like rock, paper, scissors, shoot. 1, 2, 3, thank you. Ready? Here we go, let's try it. 1, 2, 3, thank you. Did anybody beat all these hugs that are up here? Did anybody clap? I didn't hear a clap. Did somebody clap? You clapped? Oh, you're going to have to clap louder. You shook? All right, let's try that again. Ready? 3, 2, 1, thank you. Oh, yeah, you guys got it. Okay, we're going to do an elimination round with all you kids. But not just that, you guys in the audience, you're going to participate too. So why don't you all stand up, and you can find people just near you. Okay, you don't have to go around searching, just those that are standing by. If you lose, you sit down. All right, if you tie, you can stay in for the next round. Ready? All right, so you need to partner up. Find a person. You want to? I'll be your partner, Kinsley. All right, come on. You ready? All right, so ready? Here we go. 3, 2, 1, thank you. Did you hug? Did you shake? Did you clap? We tied. All right, sit down if you lost. I can't keep track of all of you, so be honest. Okay, perfect. Let's do it again. Ready? 3, 2, 1, thank you. Oh my goodness. You guys are doing great, except for all my kids up here seem like they keep tying. All right, here we go. Last time, ready? 3, 2, 1, thank you. You guys keep switching up here. All right. No. You're going to stay up here. I know you want to sit down, but you're going to stay. Okay. All right. Good job. You guys did great. Who's still standing? I'm sorry. Who won in the audience? I got 4 people still standing. Is that right? You guys did great. I don't have anything for you. Sorry. I mean, thank you for participating. All right, we after fun activity, we go into a time of, we're going to sing a song. And I know you don't want to, but we're going to do it. So those of you in the audience, please join us. Words and motions are on the screen. Hit it, Bob.
Awesome.
guys. That was awesome. That was good job. Good job. Thank you. All right. Why don't you all sit and take a look? You can face them, face me. You guys are going to help me do the story too. So, all right. So, story time. We're going to talk about Jesus, and Jesus loved telling stories, and often told stories in the Bible in order to explain things to us in a way that we understood using everyday life examples. And this story is about the kingdom of heaven, and it comes from the book of Matthew in chapter 20. Now, before I get into this story, you guys are going to help me, and Asher, Elijah, you guys are up first. So you guys can stand up. Yeah, it'll be good for you, I promise. So here's how this is going to work. As I tell the Bible story, you're going to do jumping jacks. All right? The whole time I'm telling the story, you do your jumping jacks. Can do that? All right. And at the end of the jumping jacks, I am going to give you 100 Mr. Drew dollars. Okay? It's got my face and everything. 100 Drew dollars. At the end. At the end of the story, you got to do it through the whole time. Okay? Good? All right, here we go. Go ahead and start. Here's a story Jesus told. A man who owned land went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard, and he agreed to pay them a regular amount for a day's work, 100 Drew dollars. Okay, so here you go. You guys are my early morning people. Keep going, keep going. I'm not done yet. All right. And then, around 9 a.m., the owner went out again, and he hired some more workers. I will pay you what's right. All right, you two girls, you're going to be my 9 o'clock workers, all right? Can you guys do some jumping jacks? I will pay you what is right. All right, go ahead. Jumping jacks, thanks for working. All right, all day they worked. The owner went out again about noon and did the same thing. But you know what? Before noon, I'm going to give you guys a lunch break. So go ahead, you can stop. Have a break. Oh, that feel good? All right. But see, here's the deal. I got workers at noon. So here you go. Briley, Ari, you guys are going to be my noon workers. Here they go. Okay. So you guys are going to do jumping jacks next. Okay. Oh. All right. Lunch is over. Get back to work. Start jumping. Oh, yeah. Jumping jacks. We just start working. All right. The owner went out again at 3 in the afternoon and hired some more workers. All right, here you go. You two, you be my 3 o'clock workers. All right, you guys are doing great. All right, and then again, the owner at 5 p.m. went out and found other workers. And he went to those workers and he said, "What have you guys been doing all day? You've been standing here, no one's hired you? Come work for me." So, all right, all 5 of you, you stand up and you start jumping. All right, look at my workers. I guess you guys are getting tired, huh? Okay, end of the day, you can stop working. Woo. All right, but stay standing because I got to pay you, right? I'm going to pay you guys. All right, here we go. In the story, the owner told the person in charge of the workers, and he said, "Call the workers to me, and I will give them their pay." And the owner told him to start with the last ones that had hired, and then go on to the first ones. So the workers that were hired at 5 p.m. got a normal day pay. There's 100 Drew dollars. There's 100. There's 100. There's 100. Okay. Okay. All right. All right. Then the 3 o'clock workers came. Here's 100. Okay, perfect. All right. And then those that started at noon. Oh, I forgot to give you your. Here's your. Oh, here you go. Here's your. Okay. All right. Let's see. That was noon. And then the workers who had started at 9 a.m. Here's your 100 Drew dollars. There's 100 Drew dollars. Okay. And then finally, the gentleman that started early in the morning came to collect their pay. Here's 100 Drew dollars. There's 100 Drew dollars. You guys want 100 Drew dollars? There you go. I'll give that to you too. Perfect. All right. Do you think that's, do you guys agree that was all fair?
Yeah.
Yeah? You guys got paid all the same amount, right? What? You worked all day?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. All right.
Can we change this?
No. all right, you can have a seat and listen to the rest of the story here. Those that were hired first, guess what? They expected to be paid more, just like you did. You worked all day, and they started to complain. We can imagine why, right? You worked all day. You should feel like you should get paid more. But everyone got the same pay at the end of the day, even those who had barely done anything. Here's what the owner said. In Matthew 20, 13 through 15, he said this, "Friend, I am being fair to you. Didn't you agree to work for the usual day's pay? Take your money and go. I want to give the one I hired last the same pay I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my money?" All right? And that's a hard concept for some of us when we feel like we've done more work than others. Jesus told this story to make it very clear for us. He told us this: God gives freely to everyone. It can be tough to be grateful when we see what other people are getting or what other people have, and we start to wish we had more. And that's why we have to be careful in this idea of gratitude and being thankful. Sometimes it's all about our attitude in things. And we are told in Scripture in 1 Thessalonians 5:18 to give thanks no matter what happens. God wants you to thank Him because you believe in Jesus Christ. So for those of us in Christ and the things that God does for us and the things that happen to us, we are to give thanks in what? In all things, right? All things, even the hard things. Sometimes things don't seem fair. Things don't work out the way you were hoping for. But in all things, to give thanks. Oh, yeah, see? You guys aren't even being thankful now after I just told you the story. To be thankful in everything that you get. All right, and that's hard to do. Obviously, you guys are showing me it's hard to have that attitude towards things. All right, but God can help us. When we ask for an attitude change, when we ask God for things, and it's according to His will, He helps us in changing our attitudes and acting more like Christ, right? We have a lot of things to be thankful for, right? One of the big things as we move into December, we are moving into Christmas, right? And what do we celebrate for Christmas? Jesus's, birth, right? There's so much in that alone to be thankful for. And that should help us be of an attitude where we're always full of gratitude towards people and towards the things that happen to us in life. All right? You guys think you can do that? That's your challenge as you guys leave here today, because you guys thank you. You guys were a big help to me. I couldn't have done this story without you working out. So, all right. Let's pray. You guys pray with me? All right. Dear God, it's so easy for us to focus on what we don't have. And God, when we complain and when we have a bad attitude, Father, sometimes it's hard to remember to be thankful for the things you've done for us. God, help us to adjust our attitudes so we can be grateful in all things that you do for us and the things that we don't quite understand or see. Father, help us to be thankful towards you. Help us to see all the good things in our life instead of complaining or feeling jealous. God, we thank you for what you've done for us, and we love you, Father. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you guys were an excellent help. Thank you. You can have a seat, and you can keep your Drew dollars. I might collect those and have you turn them in sometime.
All right. So this gives you just a glimpse. It's some of the ministry that takes place within our kids' ministry. I so appreciate Drew and our children's ministry team for the work they put into evaluating how do we walk alongside and disciple our children. And that's a huge importance, and we're really fortunate here to have an abundance of young families and kids. And this is even just a glimpse of what takes place on our Wednesday evenings. So if you ever wonder what goes on Wednesday evenings, right now it's a little fragmented in the sense that they do one age group on the first Wednesday of the month, another age group on the second Wednesday of the month, instead of everyone being here all at once. That's just a modification we've made in this season so that we still have ministry going on for our kids, but just a little different. And it's really interesting, too, because one of the things as staff that we have realized through this time is that most families have largely depended on church programs for a majority of the discipleship of their kids. Most families have depended on the curriculum that their kids get on Sundays or during the midweek time to make up for this is your Bible time. And so the challenge as staff has been how we equip you as parents as the primary disciple makers in your homes. It's not the church as in the organization that does that, but rather we partner with the families for the purpose of seeing that happen and happen well. Because the reality is the amount of hours that your kids spend here in comparison to the amount of hours they spend at home is a big difference, okay? And so I encourage you, especially you parents, but also any of you that are grandparents, if you're looking for resources, if you're looking for ways to be equipped with how do I walk alongside and disciple my kids to be more like Jesus, let us know. Talk to Pastor Drew, talk to Brandon, talk to myself. We are all eager and have a desire to see you as families equipped with not just the knowledge of the gospel, but the tools to bring that to be in your homes throughout the week, okay? So just a little note on that, and I'm thankful for the opportunity just to see that a little bit as a church body this morning. Take your Bibles and open up to the book of Galatians, and open up to Galatians chapter 1, and does anyone need a Bible? Put your hands up. If you need a Bible, just raise your hand. And make sure you have a copy of God's Word in front of you. And we're going to do things a little different. We're in our final message in our series through the book of Galatians. This is week 12. Believe it or not, we've been in the book of Galatians for 12 weeks. If you missed any of those, all of those resources are available on our website. You can find the full videos on our Facebook page. If you have any trouble accessing that, reach out to us, let us know. Even if you're primarily tuning in live, if you need help finding that, give us a call, send us an email. We want to be able to help you best we can. And I've been saying for a couple of weeks now, we're going to finish this series up a little differently, and that's exactly what we're going to do. We have spent 11 weeks going chapter by chapter through Galatians, and over that span of time, it can become somewhat challenging to remember the whole of what was taught. And so for this final time in Galatians this year, what we're actually going to do here in a moment is I'm going to start in chapter 1, and I'm going to read the text all the way through to the end of chapter 6. Start in chapter 1 all the way to chapter 6. And some of you may go, well, what's the point of that? I could sit down and read scripture on my own anytime. What is the value of us doing that together? And to give a better, more broad explanation of this and really a biblical backing for this, I'm going to pause for a minute. I'm going to show you a 3-minute video that does a fantastic job of explaining the historical significance of reading scripture corporately together and the impact it can have on God's people when we do that and recognize its importance. So I'll turn your attention here. Let's watch this video.
I was reading the Bible, which, you know, is kind of hard to do, but I came across this verse that says, devote yourself to the public reading of scripture, to preaching and teaching.
Yeah, this is in Paul's letter to Timothy, who's a young pastor, and he's telling him about ways that he can keep his church community engaged with Scripture.
Okay, so preaching the Bible, I get. Teaching from the Bible, I get that too. But what about this reading scripture together thing? Is that something I'm supposed to care about? Why did Paul think it was so important?
Oh man, for Paul, this was a really significant practice for the people of God. Think all the way back to Mount Sinai, where the Israelites were just rescued from Egypt. They're no longer slaves, and they need a new identity, a new story to live by. And so Moses, he gathers the people together, and he reads the scriptures aloud. He reminds them of where they came from, who they are, and the new future that they're called to live for.
This was the first public reading of scripture in the Bible.
Yeah, and it didn't stop there. When the people finally got into the land, they did it again. Joshua pulled the people together, and they all listened to the scriptures read aloud so they could remember where they came from and how they could keep living as a part of this new story.
So this is something they did all the time, then?
Well, actually, no. After Joshua died, we don't have any more stories of the people coming together to hear God's word. Instead, the people forgot their story, and a whole generation arose that didn't know their God or what God had done for them. But then, centuries later, a king named Josiah rediscovered the scriptures, and he was so excited that he called Israel to begin this practice once again. It sparked a renewal movement. That is, until the people forgot once more, and they ended up in exile. And so this is why, when Ezra and Nehemiah came back from the exile, they needed to remind the people who they are and how they are to live.
So this is a powerful practice.
Yeah, in fact, reading scripture together became a core part of Jewish life. It was done every week as they gathered in synagogue. Jesus himself participated in this practice. He even launched his mission during the weekly reading of the scriptures. He read from the scroll of Isaiah, and then he told everyone these words were about him. And that brings us all the way back to the early church, where Paul told Timothy to keep this practice going, to immerse the whole community in the story of the scriptures.
Okay, but here's the thing. Most people back then didn't know how to read, so they had to do it publicly. But I can read the Bible by myself.
Yeah, and you should totally do that. But don't underestimate the power of this ancient practice. Reading the Bible by yourself can be hard. It can be easy to get distracted. But something happens when you hear God's word read aloud and when you're with other people. And besides, it's really easy. You don't need anyone to preach or teach. You just need to listen to the scriptures and then talk about what you've heard. This is what God's people have always done when they enter into new and uncertain times. They remember their story and who they are through the public reading of the scriptures.
This is a pretty good overview and gives us some insight into what can be the value of just reading the scriptural text together. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to pray for us. I'm going to pray that this would be clear. And then I've challenged you guys through this whole series to read through the whole letter. Well, after today, every one of you who's here or who's tuning in online, you're going to have read through the whole letter. And my prayer is that we will see the entire scope of what Paul is communicating to the churches in Galatia. And that then at the end of that, I'm going to summarize three major themes that have profound application for us right here, right now, as we consider what Paul's writing. Okay? So let's pray and then we're going to jump in. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for your grace, for the freedom we have to gather together, both in person and online. I thank you for those who've taken the time to set aside and say, this is valuable. Father, I pray that as we read now this letter from the Apostle Paul to the churches in Galatia, that we would be equipped, we would be challenged, we would be motivated to be the very church that you have called us to be right here in Canton, Illinois. Father, we commit this to you for your glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to start in Galatians 1, verse 1, and I'm going to be reading out of the ESV translation. So just so you guys know what translation I'm going to be reading out of, and you can follow along, and we're going to go all the way to the end of Paul's letter. Paul, an apostle, not from men, nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brothers who are with me to the churches of Galatia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you received, let him be accursed. For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ. For I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel. For I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people. So extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. But when he who had set me apart before I was born and who called me by his grace was pleased to reveal his son to me in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with anyone, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me, but I went away into Arabia and returned again to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and remained with him 15 days. But I saw none of the other apostles except James, the Lord's brother. In what I am writing to you before God, I do not lie. Then I went into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and I was still unknown in person to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only were hearing it said, he who used to persecute us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy, and they glorified God because of me. Then, after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, taking Titus along with me. I went up because of a revelation and set before them, though privately before those who seemed influential, the gospel that I proclaim among the Gentiles, in order to make sure I was not running or had not run in vain. But even Titus, who was with me, was not forced to be circumcised, though he was a Greek. Yet because of false brothers secretly brought in, who slipped in to spy out our freedom that we have in Christ, so that they might bring us into slavery, to them we did not yield in submission even for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. And from those who seemed to be influential, what they were makes no difference to me. God shows no partiality. Those, I say, who seemed influential added nothing to me. On the contrary, when they saw that I had been entrusted with the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been entrusted with the gospel to the circumcised, for he who worked through Peter for his apostolic ministry to the circumcised worked also through me for mine to the Gentiles. And when James and Cephas and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given to me, they gave the right hand of fellowship to Barnabas and me, that we should go to the Gentiles, and they to the circumcised. Only they asked us to remember the poor, the very thing I was eager to do. But when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he was eating with the Gentiles. But when they came, he drew back and separated himself, fearing the circumcision party. And the rest of the Jews acted hypocritically along with him, so that even Barnabas was led astray by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas before them all, if you, though a Jew, live like a Gentile and not like a Jew, how can you force the Gentiles to live like Jews? We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. Yet we know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law, because by works of the law, no one will be justified. But if in our endeavor to be justified in Christ, we too are found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. For if I rebuild what I tore down, I prove myself to be a transgressor. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you only this: did you receive the Spirit by works of the law, or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? Did you suffer so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by works of the law, or by hearing with faith? Just as Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Know then that it is those of faith who are sons of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, "In you shall all the nations be blessed." So then, those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on works of the law are under a curse, for it is written, "Cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them." Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith; rather, the one who does them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, "Cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree." So that in Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith. To give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it has been ratified. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, "and to offsprings," referring to many, but referring to one. "And to your offspring, who is Christ." This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterwards, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions, until the offspring should come to whom the promise had been made. And it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. Is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the Scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian, for in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. I mean that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything, but he is under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Formerly, when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world, whose slaves you want to be once more? You observe days and months and seasons and years. I am afraid I may have labored over you in vain. Brothers, I entreat you, become as I am, for I also have become as you are. You did me no wrong. You know it was because of bodily ailment that I preached the gospel to you at first. And though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. What then has become of your blessedness? For I testify to you that if possible, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. Have I then become your enemy by telling you the truth? They make much of you, but for no good purpose. They want to shut you out, that you may make much of them. It is always good to be made much of for a good purpose, and not only when I am present with you, my little children, for whom I am again in the anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. I wish I could be present with you now and change my tone, for I'm perplexed about you. Tell me, you who desire to be under the law, do you not listen to the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a slave woman and one by a free woman. But the son of the slave was born according to the flesh, while the son of the free was born through promise. Now this may be interpreted allegorically. These women are two covenants. One is from Mount Sinai bearing children for slavery. She is Hagar. Now Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia. She corresponds to the present Jerusalem. For she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free, and she is our mother. For it is written, Rejoice, O barren one who does not bear. Break forth and cry aloud, you who are not in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than those of the one who has a husband. Now you, brothers, like Isaac, are children of promise. But just as at that time he who was born according to the flesh persecuted him who was born according to the Spirit. So also it is now. But what does the Scripture say? Cast out the slave woman and her son, for the son of the slave woman shall not inherit the son of the free woman. So, brothers, we are not children of the slave, but of the free woman. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Look, I, Paul, say to you that if you accept circumcision, Christ will be of no advantage to you. I testify again to every man who accepts circumcision that he is obligated to keep the whole law. You are severed from Christ, you who would be justified by the law. You have fallen away from grace. For through the Spirit, by faith, we ourselves eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith working through love. You were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion is not from him who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in the Lord that you will take no other view, and the one who is troubling you will bear the penalty, whoever he is. But if I, brothers, still preach circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. I wish those who unsettle you would emasculate themselves. For you are called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk in the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each will have to bear his own load. Let the one who is taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. See with what large letters I'm writing to you with my own hand. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh who would force you to be circumcised, and only in order that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. For even those who are circumcised do not themselves keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised, that they may boast in your flesh. But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision counts for anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. And as for all who walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon the Israel of God. From now on, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body the marks of Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brothers. Amen. Praise God for his word. Amen. So as we finish this time and this series, I want to highlight three important themes that we see in the letter to the churches of Galatia. Number one, the greatest threat to the church is not outside the church. The greatest threat to the church is not outside the church. It is always inside the church. What do I mean by that? Twisting of the gospel message and people allowing that message to be twisted happens within the body of Christ. Only when God's people give themselves over to a false gospel does the gospel become irrelevant. And as the statement has been said previously, we are always, church, one generation away from the church dying off. Always. Secondly, demanding more than faith alone in Christ alone always comes from within the church. When we look at the gospel and say salvation is by faith alone in Christ alone, it is in the walls of the church that that gets contorted and things get added to that. The greatest threat to the church is not outside the church, it's inside the body of Christ. Reason number three that's true: legalism is developed within the family of Christ. No one steps into something assuming that they want to be legalistic, but it happens. And it happens within the church, not because of outside. The fourth reason that this is true is that people within the church start seeing the church as the ultimate authority rather than God himself. And when that takes place, it is a threat to the one true gospel, which is only possible through the authority of God who sent his Son, the only one who can make amends for the sin of mankind. The second theme in Galatians, those in Christ are justified, adopted, and heirs with Jesus. Those words are repeated throughout the letter as Paul emphasizes and returns to this, that those in Christ have justification, but it is only those in Christ who are children of God. It is only those in Christ who are justified. They're adopted, and they're promised to be co-heirs with Christ. Praise God for those theological truths rich throughout this letter. And the third and final theme that I want to draw to your attention as we finish this series in Galatians is that there is freedom in Christ. And the challenge for us, church, is in recognizing the freedom we have in Jesus, do not return again to a yoke of slavery. Do not return again to bondage that you have been set free from. Because there is freedom in Jesus. And so as we finish this, I pray that you recognize and can speak the truth that I have freedom in Christ. And nothing can take that freedom away because it is given by the only true authority we have, which is God, the very author of his word. And that as we go from this place, that we would be motivated by the freedom we have to set aside those things which threaten us to live in that freedom. To stop. And anytime we consider Paul's words to the churches in Galatia, that we go, may I not distort the only true gospel of Jesus. And may I live and walk and breathe out of the freedom that I've been given that I do not deserve in Christ. Amen? Amen. So here's what I want to do, okay? I want to close us in prayer. And as we close in prayer, I don't know if you recognize this or not, but today is the beginning of Advent. This Sunday marks the beginning of Advent. And if you don't know what the significance of Advent is, your homework this week is to do some research, okay? Do some research on this. And in fact, to help this be a little easier, if you go to our website, there is a tab on the main menu bar that says Advent. And we have a link there to an EFCA article explaining Advent. And then we're going to put resources there. A couple of Advent devotionals. Drew's going to put his kids' curriculum that he talked about this morning for Advent season on that page. You can download those, and I encourage you to use those. But really, the significance comes down to this. Advent is the mark of the new calendar year in the Christian faith. Today is meant to mark a new beginning as we anticipate the birth of the Savior, and we go full circle to his ministry, his life, his death, his resurrection, and the ministry thereafter that stemmed from the fulfillment of the prophecies in Christ. And so, ask yourself this question and make a personal spiritual resolution as we begin this Advent season. What is it that needs to change? What is it that needs to shift? And allow these days leading up to the celebration of the Savior's birth be a kickstarter to those resolutions, okay? I'm going to pray for us, and then we've got one more missions video that we're going to show you at the very end before I dismiss you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your love for us. Thank you for all that you have done and accomplished through Christ. May we walk and live as people devoted to the true gospel, set free in Christ for your purposes. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we're pausing just a minute. This missionary video we're going to show you, we're